I happened to start dating a guy that was, you know, very dark skinned. And, you know, I thought we made a real cute couple. I was really, you know, kind of taken by it all. And he told me later in the relationship, he was from Washington. I was saying that I was going to school in Washington and he should take me to meet his mother. He said, oh no, I could never take you to meet my mother. I said, why not? And he said, because you're too dark skinned. She told me don't ever bring anyone into the house that was dark skinned because I'm too dark, he said. And because he was too dark. And that she felt that he should date lighter skinned women, even white women, to lighten his family up.
How did that make you feel?
Made me feel lousy, absolutely lousy.
Ebony, coal black, skillet blonde, tar baby, red bone, light bright and damn near white, high yellow, cinnamon,
teasing brown,
a whole lot of yellow gone to waste,
meringue,
chocolate to the bone,
brown
sugar,
lemon
color,
honey pecan.
Two-tone liver lips, nose as flat as Aunt Jemima pancake. Good hair.
Bad hair.
Tack hair.
Nappy headed.
Nice nap.
Wavy hair. Blow hair.
Bald head.
Blue black.
Nearly 400 years have passed since the first Africans were brought in chains to the United States. We have experienced slavery, apartheid, and institutional racism. It has affected how we see ourselves, our community, and how we relate to one another.
If you're light, you're all right.
If you're brown, stick around.
If you're black, get back, get back, get back.
That's me, Kathy Sandler. I spent 8 years making this film about attitudes about color in the African-American community. I am a Black American woman from an interracial background. I look white. I identify myself as black.
I made this film about color in the black community because I started from an individual standpoint of wanting to understand something that had a very dominant influence in my life.
See, I heard that before you did.
I wanted to see the whole issue as it affected my community and then create a canvas which people could look upon to understand the experiences of other black people.
I don't think that any black person hasn't at one time or another been insecure about color because it is such an issue in black, in our community. Whether you're light-skinned or you're dark-skinned, somehow you've been challenged about it. Somehow you've been either called some kind of name from your own people.
One side of the family was very light colored and the other side was dark. And with us being brown, we didn't fit in anywhere.
Every man in my family.
I had an aunt who used to come, a great aunt, who would come and she would tell all of our cousins who had curly hair or who were light-skinned that they were pretty and how cute they were and how pretty they looked, but she never said anything to my sister and me, and we always felt we must have been the ugliest kids in the world.
This is a white man's world, and I think that it does benefit me to be a lighter-skinned black because I'm able to blend in, you know, in a white man's world. A little, I don't stand out as much as probably a darker-skinned black.
Long before the 60s, when I used to hear that statement, she's dark, but she's pretty, I always questioned that in my mind. What do they mean, she's dark, but? I could never understand that statement.
I prefer lighter skin, black women. And then I'm into the hair thing. I like, you know, light skin, nice eyes, and long hair.
I think that people don't even realize what they're saying. Some people, at least today, they may think or say that they don't have any problems with color, but there are still things that creep into their conversation that just don't jive. You still hear people saying the thing about good hair.
Well, I'm gonna be honest with you. I've caught myself saying it, you know? I've caught myself saying it. After I talked to Kathy, well, the time we talked before, you know, I thought about the times, and I've caught myself saying it also, you know what I'm saying? You know, and I have to be, you know, I've been guilty of it, you know.
But do you feel that way?
You know, I don't know, you know,
disown you.
Excuse me? Maybe, you know, no, you know, it could be there subconsciously. It really could be, you know what I'm saying? Really, you know, I don't know.
With you being a dark-skinned man, do you think that you can be handsome?
I'm sure it's said in reverse, you know, I'm sure it's said in reverse.
But how do you feel behind this, when this is said?
How do I feel? I've never thought about it like that.
For African Americans, color consciousness can be traced to our early beginnings in the South. I went to Tuskegee, Alabama, a predominantly black city, which, like the rest of the South, emerged from the shadow of legal apartheid or racial segregation in the late 1960s.
All right, if you would allow me, I want to show you some of the beginning of my family.
One of the first people I met was Mrs. Annie Caldwell, a 96-year-old resident of Tuskegee. She had experienced racial segregation most of her life, as well as the color divisions in the black community that were a result of it.
I'm real dog, and you're light. We didn't care a thing about mixing with somebody your color. They would always think theirs better than we were, because our skin was black, and theirs was light. But it never did make no difference to me. I know they couldn't go no further with the white than I could. Am I doing right? And we could always keep them straight. You are no more than me because you are mixed. I would tell them right quick, you are mixed. I am straight because I'm a black African person.
Tuskegee is the home of one of the leading black schools, Tuskegee University, where Booker T. Washington was its first president. Dr. Benjamin Peyton is the university's fifth president.
Among black Americans, the most significant factor in the formation of the social class structure was the impact of slavery. Slavery itself divided blacks. It picked certain blacks to work in the big house. It had certain other blacks who worked as craftsmen, as drivers, who led the field hands, and then others who were just field hands. In that setting, whites were absolutely all-powerful. A white man, being all-powerful, he could have any woman he wanted to, including the wives of the slaves on the plantation. The source of much of the variety of colors in black America results from the sexual imposition of white men on black women. That led to the development of opportunities for the offspring of those unions. Booker T. Washington himself was sired by a white man and worked in and around the big house. He would listen to what was being said around the table. He learned about how power operated as a result of that opportunity to be present. And so it's no mystery as to why the blacks who had leadership positions following slavery were those who were light-skinned. Nobody at Tuskegee, as far as I know, ever protested the fact that we've had mostly light-skinned presidents, and all very light-skinned, who had very light-skinned wives. I am the first president of Tuskegee University to have a dark-skinned wife. Well, that's totally a function of the education that I and my wife have had.
Dr. Peyton is dark-complected, and let me just tell you, a lot of the older ladies in the community, socialites, had a lot of problems with Dr. Peyton, primarily because he was dark-skinned. They said he doesn't look like a, he doesn't need to be a president of Tuskegee University.
I'm also the first president of Tuskegee University to have as many Ivy League degrees as I have. I went to Harvard, to Columbia, and to Yale.
They just wanted a president, somebody that they could identify with and look up to, that was going to represent the university, to be tall, light, and handsome, instead of tall, dark, and qualified.
Well, you know, you have the old saying, the house niggas and the field niggas. I mean, it was really one of those situations where persons who were fair-skinned, who had wavy hair, light complexions, who looked like they were white, essentially, they were the elite, and they thought that way.
Johnny Ford became the first African-American mayor of Tuskegee and found that he had to not only overcome white segregation, but also color and class discrimination in the black community.
Well, there were some who would rather have seen the white mayor continue as mayor rather than me, because I was not one of the class members. I was too dark, or I was not from a wealthy family. I grew up and was raised on that side of town, quote unquote. In a shotgun house, no indoor running water or plumbing. And there were some in the community who did not think that if a black was going to be elected mayor, that it ought to be, quote unquote, someone from the other side of the town. And so I grew up in that kind of climate here in Tuskegee.
Diamond.
Okay. You could ask anyone in Tuskegee, do you know the Davis family? And the reply would be yes. Bobby has worked at the Alabama Exchange Bank for many years as president. I feel real proud of Bobby.
Good. You're looking mighty sassy today.
Oh, am I?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, good. I love sassy.
A lot of people crack on me, what I would call crack on me, or they comment because I'm light complected and wavy hair and kind of halfway handsome. They make comments like, you think you're better than everybody else just because you're high yellow, that type of thing. I don't really let it bother me because I can't help the complexion that I am. The neighborhood that I grew up in was a more well-to-do neighborhood, and it consisted primarily of lighter-complected folks. We were looked at as uppity-type folk, and I don't know whether it was because of our money or because of our complexion.
We never thought we were light-skinned, so to speak. That never came across our minds, because this is the color that we were born. And I guess perhaps if we were dark-skinned, we would still be regarded as respectable citizens.
You know, growing up, my mom would make the comments, get you somebody that's your complexion. Don't talk to her because she's too dark.
I never dealt with those people when I was a child because I was raised by my grandparents. They did not socialize with that group of people. They were not in the same economic bracket. My grandmother was married to a very, very dark-skinned man. She was very proud of the man that she married. She always taught me that the best thing that a person can do is just to be oneself. And that not only means being yourself in terms of the way that you carry yourself, in terms of your personality and your disposition, but it also means in terms of the way that you look. I went to a middle school that brought many of the kids together. So many of the girls who were very popular were the light-skinned girls with the pretty hair, the long hair. Their parents were generally the ones who were well-to-do in the community. And I always wondered why the families that seemed to have the most money in the community were always light-skinned. Those are the same people that I'm dealing with on a day-to-day basis. Growing up, one of the people that I was in awe of was the mayor, Johnny Ford.
The fact that now the mayor of the city is black, he's has African features, his hair is nappy, and, you know, so then that must be all right. So in a sense, it has helped younger people and some old people as well, too, who have thought all along that they were really all right and that they were really beautiful, now realize that you don't have to be light-skinned or you don't have to have curly hair to be in a leadership role.
For black people to obtain a greater appreciation of who we are in terms of the way that we look, we actually need to go back to Africa. We need to examine the way that African people look, and we need to be open-minded enough to realize that there is beauty in the way that African people look. A lot of the problems that we have with ourselves is the result of the problems that white people have with black people and the way that we look. I've never seen a black person born with chemically processed hair. If your hair is naturally curly and you're a black person, then that's fine. But I have a problem with people who feel that the way that they're born looking is not good enough for them to succeed, or it's not good enough to live up to someone else's standards.
From southern towns to northern cities, the issue of color pervades our lives.
Keith is Shay. I call him Shay, and nobody understands what I'm saying but me. We're best friends. And we're there for each other.
Yo, police, yo!
All right, now, listen closely. But you do remember to bring in the beat, to bring in the bass line when I say sweeten it up, and give me the boom, 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 boom when I tell you break it down. Good. Now, give me the beat. Yo, it's like candy. So why don't you sweeten it up? All right, here we go. Lost boys in effect here to get respect by teaching things not taught in your history text. Cause in old mob books, Caucasians are found, but there's a lack of the yellow, red, tan, and brown. Messed up culture that we're living in. People judging other people by the color of skin. Make some change the hair or the tone of their face. But you are who you are, you can't get rid of your race. So don't try to change your hair so you can get ahead fast. The best way to move ahead is to remember your past is where you came from. I don't think they understand this. What you came from?
Shay is always the cute one. He's the cute one because he's the one with the light skin and the nice hair. And it's like he smiles and gives everybody that little adorable look. And it's like Shay is always the cute one. And it has even gone as far as to the point where I'd be trying to talk to somebody and they'd be like, yeah, you cute and a whole bit, but who's the light-skinned one? And it's like, that's rough.
If I should be walking up the block and we decided to talk to two girls, the girls were like, well, you're all right, but your light-skinned friend, he's cute, you know, and he's got nice textured hair and he's, you know, his face is so babyish and, you know, you're average because you're just a normal black kid. Keon, since I've known him, always tried to change himself. You know, he put contacts in his eyes.
He can't identify with that. He can't identify with looking in the mirror saying, am I too dark?
He may feel, at the time, you know, rejected, just a little rejection. But yet, he and I are above that. You know, we know that I'm light-skinned, and he knows that my hair is a better texture, or, you know, a different texture is no better. It's just a different texture. And that being in America, people like white. People like light.
We don't even discuss it between the two of us, and we're best friends. I mean, I know why I don't bring it up. I don't bring it up because I wouldn't want to cause an argument over something like that. Because we're not friends over the color of our skin. We're friends over the people that we are. We'll be hanging out, and we'll make, even us as a group, we'll make jokes about the tone of somebody. We only judge females on their complexion. It'll be like, you look at a person who's real dark-skinned and be like, damn, she's dark. And it's like, then that automatically becomes funny. And it's like, everybody goes along with it. And I know there's times where I've thought, hey, that ain't funny. But you go along with it just so that you don't stick out. You go along with it so that you don't have to be the odd man. It's like everybody else is laughing, you might as well laugh. Because if you don't laugh, then it's like, well, what's wrong with you?
Y'all got over because y'all light, bright, almost white.
Keith will say things like, the damn, she's dark. Because he is light-skinned. And there's no people walking around saying, damn, he's light. Because that ain't a problem. I resent that. I resent that. Sometimes I get to the point where it's like, how dare you?
A light-skinned woman was a prize.
I often wonder if there are conflicts between black women of different complexions because we allow our value as women to be determined by how attractive we are to men, mainly black men, who are guided by a color-conscious standard.
I never understood why I was considered light-skinned. But walking with a friend of yours who was darker, even half a shade, a hair darker, and hearing the boys yell out or leer out something that would stop the both of you, and then having them dismiss and your friend saying, no, 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 I was talking to the bright one. You know, I was talking to the light-skinned one.
People expect dark-skinned women to be just grateful to be alive. I'm just so glad I'm here. You're not supposed to want anything. You're not supposed to have anything. You're not supposed to excel.
You were something to be conquered. You were something to be. You were a conquest, okay? You weren't a person.
I was thought of as a little darky, like a little black Sambo. And that was before the advent of black being beautiful. And it was hard, it hurt. You had to be smarter, you had to be a better athlete, you had to be better than everybody. I'm talking about light-skinned girls, girls who had light complexions, I'm talking about white girls.
There's a resentment that you face from other black people.
They don't have to be anything except light, just light-skinned. You can be ugly. You can be unintelligent. You can be homely. But as long as your skin is light, which relates to kind of being white, it's just okay.
From my side of the fence, it seemed like everybody else could just be a person. But I had to be a light-skinned person. And I wasn't very happy about that.
Black people have called me half-breed. Half white, half black girl. Definitely I get angry when black people ask me, where are you from? What are you? Yellow, red bone. You're Spanish? No, I'm not Spanish. Oh, no, you're not black. Oh, you can't possibly be black. I get an attitude. Quick, I will get an attitude. Because what difference does it make what I am? What importance does that play in your life? What I am. It's none of your business. This girl came up out from nowhere. I didn't even know her. I heard you were talking about me. I said, I don't even know you. She said, well, I better not hear it again. And when she said that, I said, and if you do, her and I, she threw the first blow and we were rumbling all over that floor, you know, which I didn't have a problem with that. That was right up my alley. The fight stemmed from her jealousies. That was the bottom line, because she was black, number one. Number two, she was ugly. Number three, she had short, knotty hair. And she had a problem with my appearance. They look at a black person as black-skinned, nappy hair, and that's it. So I don't have a problem with black men. All my problems do stem from black women. I believe that the black man's ultimate goal is to be with a white woman. And maybe they can't get a white woman, but I'm the next best thing to a white woman to them. I have never been recognized as white, never wanted to be white, never tried to be white. You know, because I really wanted, you know, that friendship, that sense of belonging, that I just wanted to be black, you know.
If you look white, you can catch a lot of hostility because black people do resent the way that we are treated by white people. And so if you look like a white person and you're not identifiably black, you can catch some real hostility in the black community. And I caught that a lot growing up. You know, it caused me a lot of pain, a lot of hatred for the way that I looked. I wanted to be darker, to have kinky hair.
In 1977, when I was 17 years old, Essence, the magazine for today's black woman, called. They wanted me and my mom to be on their Mother's Day cover. Later, there was hate mail from readers wanting to know, why are you putting white women on the cover of our magazine? Meanwhile, another drama unfolded. My mother has two daughters, and my sister Eve wasn't called for that cover. Why was I the chosen Cinderella? Was it because I looked white and Eve didn't? Was my mom on the cover of Essence magazine for producing a child who looked white? How did that make Eve feel? In all these years, we have never talked about it. My pain, my alienation, was and is real, but I am cushioned by the privilege of looking like a white woman in a society where images of white women are used to oppress black women, in a society where dark-skinned women are denigrated most.
Quiet, please.
I wrote Skillet Blonde in response to all of the things that I say in the piece about growing up.
When a baby's born, particularly in the South, people come to see the baby. I'm talking about black people. They come to see the baby and they ask, how's the baby? They say, it's a skillet blonde, meaning the baby is very, very dark with African features. They are forever commenting on how you look. What they say hurts your feelings, especially when they tell you that you are entirely too dark to wear red. Red is your favorite color. How come she always grinning and showing her teeth? Look like an African with them big liver lips. She'll never be able to wear lipstick. They don't make lipstick for two-tone lips and not enough hair in the kitchen to hold a curl. Ain't it the truth? Look at them nappy edges. You believe it? She ought to be ashamed of herself. A big black gal like her acting tender-hearted.
I mean, I just remember feeling so bad being told that. You don't even know what it means, but you know it means something bad. You can't wear red. You got liver lips. Not really. You think of, you know, like a piece of liver, and your lips look like that. So what does that mean? Where do these things come from, you know? So you just think not only are you a bad kid, but your hair is bad. Your lips are bad. Your nose is bad. And then when you look around, these people who are telling you you're bad, they look the same way. So, you know, they think they're bad. They feel bad about themselves. I mean, everybody that I saw and knew had bad hair.
My mother washed our hair once every 2 weeks, and then she had to straighten it with a hot comb. It was something that took like all day. She didn't have a lot of patience. And we were tender-headed kids. And she would be just combing and then straightening, and at times she'd just, you know, sort of nick your ear or nick your neck. And I mean, that's one of the memories I have of my childhood, was going to school with your hair really nicely straightened and braids and everything, and you have a couple of these little dark brown spots either in your ear or your neck, you know, where your mother had burnt you as she was straightening your hair.
Or people say things when you get dressed up after they've greased you down in Vaseline and straightened your hair and everything. She's dark, but she's kind of pretty. I mean, you can be. You can overcome and transcend all these bad things.
There were lots of things that inhibited you, that told you that you weren't beautiful. If you were dark, if your skin was ashy, if your nose was broad, if your lips were full, if your hair was kinky.
Because you could be light and have these features, and so you still were not good, you were bad.
And I mean, I had all of those: full lips, broad nose, kinky hair, ashy skin.
You could be dark and have a keen nose. They say she's dark, but she got good features.
So-and-so had good hair, or so-and-so had bad hair. You can't grow up in an environment like that without it having some effect on you. It did inhibit you. It did have you doing lots of things to try to be other than what you were.
Who taught you to hate the texture of your hair? Who taught you to hate the color of your skin to such extent that you bleach to get like the white man? Who taught you to hate the shape of your nose and the shape of your lips? Who taught you to hate yourself from the top of your head to the soles of your feet? Who taught you to hate your own kind? Who taught you to hate the race that you belong to?
For so many, many years, we were told that only white people were beautiful. Only straight hair, light eyes, light skin was beautiful. And so black women would try everything they could, straighten their hair, lighten their skin, to look as much like white women. And the black men would let it be known that they thought white women were beautiful, and they'd say they didn't want any ugly black woman with short hair. This whole thing. But this has changed because black people are aware now that their own appearance is beautiful. They're proud of it, and white people are aware of it too, because white people now want natural wigs. They want wigs like this. Dig it? Isn't it beautiful? All right.
Put your bad self, say it louder.
In the late 1960s, millions of African Americans were touched by a mass movement of social and political consciousness, which rocked the foundations of traditional color hierarchies and became known as the Black Consciousness Movement.
We are all Africans. All black people are Africans. All Africans are black people.
In the 60s, I felt terrific because the whole African look was in, and it was like my time had come, you know. And actually, I liked the way I looked in African, they used to call it African garb. I just liked the African look. I thought it fitted with me, and I said, these people know what they're doing. Their clothes, everything is designed to enhance the natural complexion, the natural beauty of the people that wear the stuff. Those colors, everything was right. That's it. This is my stuff. Oh, I liked it.
Many people may not want to accept the fact that they're Africans, but they cannot deny that they came from Africa. And if one denies one's past and one's heritage, one has a problem. One has a problem.
I mean, there's an expression people used to use: don't wear too much jewelry, look like a Ubangi. And you knew what that meant. I mean, who wants to look like a Ubangi? Well, I liked looking like a Ubangi and a Zulu and, you know, a Dahomey person and all. That was good.
I had my afro and I looked like Angela Davis, and you couldn't tell me nothing. You know, we're not talking about little afros. We're talking about, you know, major rain cloud afros.
The 1960s, of course, was a very exciting time. Certainly my coming into the news business had to do directly with what was happening in the streets in the 1960s.
Melba Tolliver became one of the first black women reporters on network news.
There were several occasions when people stopped me on the street when I was covering a story to say, why are you still wearing your hair straightened? How come you're not wearing your hair in a natural, sister? I did not just on my own overnight say, I'm going to start wearing my hair in a natural. I was really, I say, reflecting what was happening at the time. There were people, Angela Davis and others, who were wearing their hair in naturals. And when I saw them, it just provided a context and an opportunity for me to do the same thing.
Melba encountered resistance from her station for wearing her hair naturally.
We gotta come out of this meeting or else.
Or else what?
One of the comments was, with my hair like this, I didn't look as feminine, that people wouldn't like it, and that I really had to change it. Now, I had seen at one point of the man who was producing a news show that I was on at the time take a picture of Kathleen Cleaver, and she had her hair in a big natural, and use his hand and cover up her hair and look at her picture and say, not bad. And it was just amazing. It was for him that if he removed her hair, then she was acceptable. You know, she was an acceptable, feminine creature.
Melba Tolliver was taken off the air and threatened with dismissal because she refused to straighten her hair. After a public outcry, she was reinstated and her natural remained.
I know that something different has happened. The natural hairdos that you wear mean that you're going to quit being fictitious. Not only in your hair, but in your life.
For nearly a decade, the movement helped African Americans of all ages, especially young people, reshape our self-image, and it influenced many people throughout the world.
I hear people talking about the 60s now and trashing it. And actually saying things like, well, in the 60s, when black was beautiful, it was rough for me because nobody appreciated how I looked. Well, that's a lot of people who are lighter than me saying that.
And what I probably still resent very much is the fact that every light-skinned person, particularly every light-skinned woman or girl that came into the Black Student Union, had to prove herself worthy of being in the BSU, okay? As if by being light-skinned, you were automatically suspect.
And actually, you know, I don't remember it that way at all. I remember it being very liberating.
The right's rapid rise to national political power had a chilling effect on social, political, and aesthetic alternatives. As the Reagan era approached, the Afro gave way to the Jerry Curl. The demise of the Black Consciousness Movement halted an important new dialogue around color amongst African Americans. Its loss is felt today.
Hello, hello, but hey, how you doing? It's me, the Mac of BAC, pursuing ya. Who in the world gave you the right to look so well?
While Black consciousness and Afrocentricity has powerfully resurfaced with our young people in the 90s, we see lingering contradictions as young rap artists sing to a light-skinned woman with good hair that's real to the roots.
She's as cute as a puss in boots with good hair, and it's real to the roots. Damn it, perfect on my life. I'm
turning up on high. You are turning on it second to half. I read how all that heat can be damaging. Basically, I feel that getting extensions is to have long hair. I believe that braids are black woman's great white hope, maybe. And I feel this inferiority complex starts when you start start watching TV from 2 years old up. And I know it started at 5 years old, going to first grade private school and seeing these girls, white, the only white girls with this long hair, white girl with the two little long braids, and wanting to know why I couldn't have this. Growing up watching the Supremes and the Martha and the Vandellas and Tina Turner, don't forget her, they all wore wigs. Where was their hair? Where was my role model for hair? It was missing.
And I had seen people with locks and I thought, I really should do this. And it was like, I just felt propelled, you know, it's like I must lock my hair. I think African locks, and I think it's a reaffirmation of who you are as an African American person. And I went to some woman and she put in these really tight little rolls on my head. And I thought, how is everybody else going to react to it? Because I myself, I wasn't comfortable with it initially.
Because of my inferiority complex, I don't like to see my edges kinky. I like to swim a lot in the summertime, and I still am not comfortable coming out of the water with my hair in its natural state.
I have one relative who told me, you know, when are you gonna cut that mess out of your hair? You know, I'm gonna cut it while you're sleeping. I was called all kinds of names like buckwheat and jigaboo. Why are you wearing your hair in that style? You know, it's so nappy, or, you know, what are you trying to prove? And it's like, why can't I just be who I am? You know, why do I have to opt for straightening my hair? That's not part of me. But once it started to grow out, their whole attitude about my hair changed. And I think it's because we like long hair. You know, short hair is not happening.
And I know this is my natural form of hair, now why should I be ashamed of that?
I had to become confident in myself and become really, really self-assured about my hair and to really learn to love it and to love every aspect of it, you know. And I felt I got stronger each year, you know, that went by. I got stronger and stronger in my determination and letting other people know, as well as to reaffirm it within myself, that this is the right thing, I've done the right thing, you know, and it's beautiful. There's nothing wrong with being black, there's nothing wrong with having natural hair.
I would like to have dreadlocks, but I know I'll be about 50 years old before that happens, because it's gonna take time for me to accept my hair. I'm slowly coming around, but as I said, it will take some time to unbrainwash myself.
The process itself really makes you stretch and grow, because you realize that you have problems with your own hair. I mean, you have problems with the way it looks based on what society has told you is acceptable.
The racism that we experience has taught us to be ashamed of the way we look. Has society taught us to hate what is most African about us?
Ma!
Yes, I'll be right there. Turn that fire down. I can smell the butter burning.
Father, we thank thee for the food we're about to receive, for the nourishment of our body, for Christ's sake. Amen.
That's not funny, Keon.
I'm sorry. I just never heard of an operation that can make your skin lighter.
Well, there isn't an operation.
Michael was darker than he actually is now, isn't he?
Yeah. How'd he get like that?
He injected lamb fluid into his skin.
Is that what he did?
Yeah.
Lamb's what?
Fluid.
From who?
You want to look like Michael Jackson?
I kind of thought that we had progressed past... Oh, look at you, even like that. I thought that we had progressed past that. I thought that, you know, it had to do with the content of your character, not the color of your skin.
You could have a light-skinned girl who was ugly and a dark-skinned girl who was cute, and they usually pick the light-skinned girl.
Really?
Pretty much.
Keon kind of likes light-skinned girls. Name three dark-skinned girls that you've dated in the last 3 years.
My last three girls?
Who?
Nikki, Chocolate, Ebony.
There were some others who just kind of ran in and ran out, you know.
Angela, Ramanita.
Yeah.
I'm being Puerto Rican.
Alexis.
Yeah.
What?
Sarah.
I'm just a cross-cultural brother.
If you could be lighter, would you?
his eyes. His eyes say what, Keon?
Yeah.
Yes, you do.
You think people like you better if you're light-skinned?
You think people like light-skinned people more than they like dark-skinned people in general?
Some people.
Who would like you better if you were light-skinned?
White people?
Female people.
Girls like light-skinned?
Yeah! You see her face?
That was it, huh?
You see the face?
Throughout the world, the relationship of power of white societies to communities of color affect the self-image of various people. As a result, a European or white standard of beauty has been imposed on much of the world.
Miss Belgium, Miss India, Miss Colombia, Miss Namibia. Congratulations. Miss Universe is Miss Namibia. You are the new Miss Universe 1992. You've won all the cash awards and the prizes worth more than $250,000.
Many people of color go through great pains to conform to this white ideal.
If I were going to westernize this eye, I would place the incision 10 millimeters above the margin.
Thousands of Asian women throughout the world feel compelled to alter the shape of their eyes to better fit a European standard of beauty. Cosmetic surgery is also on the rise in the African-American community. Dr. Ferdinand Ofadle, who is Nigerian, is head of plastic surgery at Harlem Hospital.
Essentially, three groups of blacks come in for a surgery. The first group, the people who want to look more Caucasian, and they come and they tell you that they want their noses to look Caucasian. The second group wants a more refined nose to fit their face, but they want to maintain the ethnic identity. They do not want the Caucasian features. In short, they don't want us to Caucasianize the nose, as we put it. The third group are the people who come to your office and tell you they don't want to look Caucasian. They want to maintain the ethnic look, but in actual fact, they want their noses to look Caucasian.
Dr. Ofadle demonstrates the kind of changes he would make on Jackie, a nurse who agreed to be his model.
Jackie is a very attractive young lady, and the facial features are essentially in balance, so she doesn't need any radical operations to alter the structures of her face. However, she can do with a little fine-tuning. Jackie's nose falls into the category that we classified as the African. In this case, the bridge is a little flat and depressed, so we have to build up the bridge. In this case, we insert this implant in this position. This will now convert this African nose to an Afro-Caucasian nose and give it a more refined, finer features. While we're at it, we may also narrow the nostrils a little bit so that the flare of the nostrils will be reduced. And at the same time, some of this fat under the skin here.
Only we can overcome our tendency to become agents of our own oppression and transcend the values that have distorted our self-image. Only then can we celebrate the rainbow of colors, hair textures, and features that are our community.
Tamu. It is unusual for someone my age to have that name from birth, but my mother was particularly interested in black culture and African heritage, and she went out of her way to give all of her children African names. In spite of the fact that this is the premier black university in America, there were a lot of people who were caught totally off guard based on the fact that they were like, but Miss Howard is dark brown skin. It was like, yes, she sure is. It was like, and she's bald headed. It was like, yeah, I am. You know, and I got a big kick out of it because it's like, I've been dark skinned and very short hair all my life, and I'm very comfortable with it. Still, traditionally, it's expected that Miss Howard would be fair skinned with long, flowing hair. The kind of image that mainstream America would teach us, this is beauty for black people. And beauty for black people, according to mainstream America, is as close to white people as you can get. And I'm about as far from white people as you can get. If you walk across this yard, you see 50 million versions of beauty. And that's part of the beauty of black people.
As black Americans, we must challenge the way we see ourselves so that we can overcome the ways we have been taught to hate ourselves. We need to honestly and openly discuss color consciousness within our families, within our institutions, and amongst one another. We need to overcome our shame about confronting these issues and face the task of healing ourselves as a community. Only then can we collectively change the way we look at ourselves and the way the world sees us.
Sometimes you laugh because you kind of feel that that's a mirror. We're laughing at that person, but somewhere there's somebody laughing at me. Somewhere there's somebody who thinks that I'm too dark.
I think we black people have changed and are changing our concept of beauty, but we still carry all of that with us. You know, we still look and we see good and bad hair, good and bad features.
These questions kind of peeled off layers about myself that I'd like to come off ideally. I'd like to sound as though I didn't have any particular preferences or I didn't make distinctions, but that wouldn't be, you know, the truth. You know, I found out in your questioning that there was a, that I had, you know, prejudices and I'd like to think that I was one way, and I'm finding out now, you know, that the other sides of me.
Well, I think with this interview today, it's almost like therapy for myself because, you know, you're saying actually that you're ashamed of your hair, and you're not just telling yourself, you're telling your friends, you're telling strangers. It's not easy to admit, but if you can admit that, that's coming to terms with yourself.
I think we have to have as many positive words to describe ourselves as possible. I think we need to get rid of all the negative that's been placed on us, and I think we have to start loving ourselves and treating ourselves in a loving way. And that means describing ourselves positively, you know, knowing that anything about us, the fullness of our noses, the fullness of our lips, the coarseness of our hair is a positive thing.
Ebony, coal black, skillet blonde, tar baby, red, red bone, light bright and damn near white, high yellow,
cinnamon,
teasing brown,
honey colored,
wasted yellow,
lemon colored,
brown sugar,
blue black,
pecan,
the black of the berry,
the sweet of the juice.
Color consciousness in black America is a consequence of racism in white America. As we struggle to redefine ourselves, we must also confront the reality that we live in a society that has failed to embrace all of us.
are you? You don't know. Don't tell me Negro, that's nothing. What were you before the white man named you a Negro? And where were you? And what did you have? What was yours? What language did you speak then? What was your name? It couldn't have been Smith or Jones or Bunch or Powell. That wasn't your name. They don't have those kind of names where you and I came from. No, what was your name?
Yes, sir.
And why don't you now know what your name was then?